What's up, everyone? Welcome to another live What Makes This Song Great. This particular song we're doing is a Steely Dan song, also off of Royal Scam. And I've gotten a lot of requests for this. People asking me about this for The Art of Soloing, one of my other series that I've done a couple videos on. And one of the reasons is because it's a Larry Carlton guitar solo again. Royal Scam came out in 1976. It was Steely Dan's, I believe, fourth record. And Larry Carlton played on this tune and played on Kid Charlemagne. And these both happen to be two of the greatest solos, I think, pretty much ever in rock music, I think, anyways. These are really unique too, because it showcases Larry's unusual note choices. And I was going to do this as The Art of Soloing, but I also want to talk about the tune as well, because it's got such an interesting chord progression and how the melody and the chord progression are interweaved. And there's a lot of modulations, really subtle modulations that happen. And Carol's actually going to play keyboards on this as well when we go over the tune. I'm going to attempt to play the solo here live and see if it's balanced with the track. So I've been practicing it here for a few minutes. I haven't played it in, I used to play it about 40 years ago when it first came out. And I had to relearn it today. And there's some tricky parts in it, in this opening solo. And this is what's really unusual and makes this song great, is that it was never a single, I don't think, but everybody knew the tune. Everybody knew it because it started, because first of all, very few songs start out with solos. Second of all, the solos are never this good. So anyways, it starts out, let me just tell you this here before I play along with it, but it starts out with a G7 sharp 9, and it's really kind of Larry Carlton voicing the way he plays it. So he starts out. So it's right here at the third fret. He starts out with a bar, and he actually lifts his pinky up and goes to this dominant 7 sharp 9. And then he does a little click before he comes into. I'm going to attempt to play along with it right now. Let's see if I can do it here. We'll see how the balance is. You can tell me. I haven't done these live. It's kind of fun to do them live because there's a lot of chance elements to it, but let's see if I can get through it. Here we go. Hold on. So, if the balance is off, Carol, you're going to tell me, right? Here we go. One more time here. How's the balance? Is it okay? Let me try one more time here. Thank you. Okay, let me talk about the solo first because it's so cool. Carol, you can actually come over and accompany me on here. So he's, like I said, he starts out with his G7 sharp 9. And he does this. And then we're into the... And then... And then he goes... And we're on... What chord are we on here, Carol?
G11,
we'll call it. And he's playing the fifth. But he's still thinking like it's a G dominant chord, right? So he's going. And you've got that flat 13. And to the root, and then. And then. And that's a really cool spot there where he's going, I play the C minor. He plays that A because he's thinking a C Dorian right there. And then goes right down the C minor chord and then the next part. Then Hold on.
Okay.
And then he ends up on that 13th, on that C, C play C minor 7. He's singing an F major upper structured triad there. Carol's not used to doing this live like this, but that's okay. Okay, so let's play it together here. Okay. Okay, that's tricky here. So, on this is very, very odd. He's doing on, and he's going from A flat major 7 to B flat major 7. And he's essentially playing a major 6th, 7th arpeggio. And then he goes into this. And then to that 13. So there's all these upper structure triads here. Now, one of the things that's going on in the chord progression that's really cool, and by the way, I'm using a new overdrive pedal that I've never used before. It's my Keeley, it's called a D&M drive. That's really cool here. I'm playing through a Silver Jubilee, and I can't really get the right tone with the right mid-range and sustain, so I'm using a pedal for it, but I'm turning it off here. One of the things about the chord progression that happens here in the intro that is really unique is that you actually have modulations going on. This happens, you know, when Larry's going. Which is really, if you think about it, you've got F minor to G minor, and then you have A flat major 7 to B flat major 7, which is essentially the same thing. F minor to G minor, okay, are the relative minors of A flat major and B flat major 7. A flat major 7, B flat major 7 do not come from the same key, so these are modulations, okay? Let's talk about the tune then as we get into the verse. Here we go. Mm-hmm. So we're into the verse. So it's C minor, and then G minor. Okay, so here's this Steely Dan chords. Carol?
Huh?
What are these chords, Carol?
I forgot. That's the third chord, right?
Okay, so you got, I'm trying to put Carol on the spot here. So. Okay. There you go. Okay, so here, I'm going to show you Carol. I told her to be ready for anything. Okay. What's really interesting about this, one of the things, is that there's a lot of chord replacement, or we're using minor here on the minor seven chord, and then in the chorus, we're going to G dominant seventh. But here, agents of the law, luckless pedestrians. Okay.
I think it's like.
That's what it is.
Yeah.
Tell them, Carol.
It's a B flat on E flat, C on F, D on G, right?
Okay. So. A lot of these Steely Dan voicings of this time period, this is kind of before they were doing the, these major nine to the mu chord, as they called them. They did a lot of major seventh chords with a ninth and no third. That's what really gives a lot of these Steely Dan songs this particular flavor. It's kind of the types of voices that they're using where they're leaving out notes. And it actually presents a really particular challenge for melodically and for soloing, because there are all these subtle possibilities of what you can do. And there are actually a lot of modulations in here. And they do this, they do a thing in the bridge. It's a similar thing. It's a lot of this modal interchange between these here. When he's doing a. And he's using that it's C Dorian. The modal interchange where, and it's kind of a real specific thing that Donald Fagen does, I think, that makes it so interesting, is the these kind of unexpected chords that have that are a half step, that will have a lift in them, just like in this part in the chorus when it's going Here, you're hearing A flat. You can get away with a note, A flat, if you were thinking, da, 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 you get away with it, but you can't get away with it on the B flat major 7. So you know that you have definitely modulated. Well, Larry Carlton, he's playing F major 9, then he's going G major 9, and then over the A major, A flat major 7, and he's going on the B flat major 7, he's doing a B flat major triad. And then comes back to C minor. But when he goes back to C minor, he's playing that as Dorian. So the F minor and C minor, that actually makes sense, right? So you get C minor, F minor, G minor. Those could all be, in the key of E flat, right? You have your six chord, your two chord, and your three chord. But once you throw in A flat, that could still be an E flat, but the B flat major 7 has the A natural in it, so that cannot be in the chord. So this modal interchange that's going on in the tune, and I really like to focus really more on what's going on in the guitar part, because I think that it's fascinating that Carlton, what he's playing on it, he immediately goes for these upper structure triads. Play the F minor 7 chord. And then, so right there, by playing the ninth on the F chord and the on the G minor, it's already implied the modulation then. And then C minor. And a lot of times he goes for the blues sound, but many of the times, like in the intro solo, he does that sixth in there, the A over the C. When he does that arpeggiated figure there, he is implying those chords, you know, literally outlining them, and then into. And he decides to hit that A note, which is really hip against the C minor chord, because it implies the Dorian. But if you think about this, he plays the A on the C all over the place in the song, on the C minor, but in the verse you have that, you have that A flat note in there. I'm sorry, on the G chord, in the verse you have the, that A note works really well, right? But in the chorus, you've gone back to F minor on the climb. You have the F A flat in the chord, but then he brings the A in on the G. So this modal interchange between these different key centers here, it's very subtle, and it's simple, yet it's actually really complex. And I can't think of another song of any, other than Steely Dan, I can't think of another group that does do these interchanges in this way. Because it's not really what a jazz musician would do. They would, I mean, some of the things that were going on at the time in the 70s, there was, you know, you got to think of this era. There was a big funk fusion thing that was going on. Where they would use these vamps, these Dorian kind of vamps like this, but they wouldn't use these major seventh chords in this way, where they connect them by steps, just like in the verse. Play the verse part there again, Carol.
Wait, oh.
Right. I know you're out there with the rage in your eyes. Yeah, right?
Is that the right part?
Yeah. Out there with rage in your eyes. No, no.
Oh, the verse.
Yeah.
Can you play along? You're out there with rage in your eyes.
So those major seventh chords are moving up in whole steps. E flat major seven, F major seven to G major seven, but they're major nine chords. They're not just straight major seven. So these are definitely modulation, right? E flat major nine to F major nine is a modulation. The G major nine is a modulation because you never have two major seventh chords that are a whole step apart in any key. So they have to, and because you have two major seventh chords in any major key, but it's always the one chord and the four chord. So that's what's so interesting about this is that the melody is really sounds natural against it. The rage in your eyes and your megaphone. Listen. It's an incredibly natural melody with a really unnatural chord progression for the time. We never thought about it when I heard it. I never thought about it. I just knew that it was really cool. And to me, that solo, this was a big introduction into jazz for me personally. When I heard the notes that Larry Carlton was playing, it was unusual. Between this and Kid Charlemagne, this record almost single-handedly got me into playing jazz, or at least turned me on to fusion, because I wanted to explore where do those notes come from. And also the weird bends that he does in this. When he's doing the... he bends up to the fourth. And then he goes... That's rude. That is so weird. Nobody really played like that. That part, then. Yeah. And when I heard that 13, I was like, what note is that? Why would anyone play that note? That is amazing. How would anyone play that? And then when I start reading about Larry Carlton, he started talking about upper structure triad. So if he's playing a C minor seven, play C minor seven there. He's thinking that A major sound. B flat major, he's thinking. Keep playing C minor seven. Oh. He's thinking F major. So there's your F major sound. That's that. So play the chord. B flat major. F major. Those are your upper structure triads on a C minor 7 chord, okay? You can play E flat major also. Play C minor 7 again. E flat. So once I knew that stuff, once I figured that solo out, 40 years ago, I knew that that there was something more out there that I needed to learn. And then I started searching out. And then my dad gave me my Joe Pass Virtuoso record. That's when I really got the jazz bug, is from that. So, oh, by the way, everybody thank Carol. Give her some applause. I totally put her under pressure here. Because she hasn't done any of these things, so.
What? Yeah, this is my first time playing piano, guys.
No, it's your first time playing piano on a live stream.
Yeah.
Actually, isn't it?
This is fun.
Except for the lick. Do the lick.
Come on.
Do you remember the lick?
Oh, Wait. Oh, I forgot.
Carol forgot the lick. Good thing you forgot the lick. Somebody's doing the lick.
10,000
times. I'm like putting Carol on the spot for the chord progression here and everything. And she's just like, and Carol has an amazing ear.
Aw.
Okay, so questions on this stuff. I really wanted to talk about the, I wanted to talk about the tune. Let me talk about the bridge on the tune, because the bridge is really cool. Really fast, I want to talk about that. Because it's... Right here, this part. So once again, it's using this C minor 7 and using the triads. It's using B flat, F, G, Dorian sounds, but the G is, once again, it uses a, is another modulation. There's all these subtle things. But this in particular, this song, even more than Kid Charlemagne, is the thing that was definitely my, I would say, this was what led me to jazz, what led me to learn how to play jazz, is really Larry Carlton's playing on this. And this hit my ear and I said, I need to know why he's playing those notes. I don't know those notes. I knew the pentatonic scale. I learned from Jimi Hendrix, Hey Joe. I learned from Zeppelin, from Hendrix, from the Beatles, from the Stones, stuff like that. I started playing lead guitar on Hey Joe with an E minor pentatonic scale. Then I heard this. It was around the same time. I mean, I started playing on 75, so this is 1 year after I started playing. And when I heard this, because I like Steely Dan, these songs were on the radio. And I bought the record, and I listened to it, Royal Scam, and then I heard that solo, and that was the gateway to me getting into jazz. And honestly, it was the gateway into me getting to all the modern classical music, everything. Hearing these upper structure notes that Larry Carlton played on this song did that itself. Okay, I'm gonna answer questions now. This is more of an unusual, this really was more of like the Art of Soloing video, but that's okay.
I saw a question.
Yes.
Do you know if Larry improvised this take or did they work it out with Becker?
You know, I always wondered that because it's so odd that to think of somebody improvising this, but the Kid Charlemagne solo is equally amazing. So I don't hear any edits. I do not have the tracks to this, but I do have the tracks to Kid Charlemagne, and I don't hear any edits in the solo. There may have been edits, but whatever edits there were, they're covered. They're inaudible. It sounds like one pass. The Kid Charlemagne solo. So I think that I got to think that this was improvised. You know, these guys. There was a time when Larry was bringing tracks. He had a studio called Room 335 at his house. I believe it was at his house, and he's one of the first guys that I knew of. Maybe only guys I knew of that people would send tracks to, and he had a. I'm pretty sure he had a reel-to-reel, and he would do his own solos at his house. Now, if that was the case, he could have worked these out, but things I've read that he did them right in the studio with those guys, and that's just mind-boggling, right? To be able to improvise a solo like this. All the bends to the 11th, the bends to the 9th, things like that. He just does unusual, so many unusual things. Jari says, quick thinking and quick ears. Exactly. Kid Charlemagne solo was a second take, Johnny says. Okay. I mean, whether it was a second take or first take, it's unbelievable, you know? This particular solo, because there's a lot of playing in this tune, more than on, I don't know about more. No, okay, there's probably equally amount. These are both this and Kid Charlemagne are total guitar features for Carlton. The fact that they happen to be amazing songs too is really incredible. Or maybe they're amazing songs that happen to be guitar features for Larry Carlton. It's really cool. You just don't see that ever. Both songs have a long solo break. They have fills all over the place. They have these ending thing. This one has the long ending solo here at the end. It's just absolutely perfect. Every lick in it. So I personally, of all the Steely Dan records, this is my favorite one by far. I like Asia. Asia's okay, but Royal Scam to me is just a superior record. It's just incredibly great. Those guys let the players play in all these tunes. You got in Asia, you've got Wayne Shorter's solo, and you have Steve Gadd's drum solo. I mean, you know, these guys let players play. Bodhisattva, Do It Again, Reeling in the Years. These songs are all amazing features for guitars, especially. My Old School, Skunk Baxter solo. These are incredible. Talk about the bass a bit. I'm not sure who played the bass on this, if it's Chuck Rainey on here. I assume it's Chuck Rainey because it sounds like it is. And he played on the on Kid Charlemagne. I'm thinking that it could be Bernard Purdy on this track as well, because they were they played. Carol, do you know who it is on this?
Yeah, there's a bunch of people on this.
Tell me who's on this here.
One of those is Becker, Mark Davis, Chuck Rainey.
Chuck Rainey on bass. But who's playing drums on it?
Who's playing drums?
Yeah. So Chuck Rainey is playing bass on it, just like Kid Charlemagne.
Rick
Marotta.
Marotta?
Yeah, so Rick Marotta is a great drummer. He and his brother Jerry are on thousands of classic records. They were, you know, Rick probably played on a few more records than Jerry, but they have very similar styles and heavy groove players, really, really kind of behind the beat feel, really in the pocket drummers, both of them. And Chuck Rainey's bass playing, it's like it is on Kid Charlemagne. It's just bom ba do da da. It's all melody playing. Phil's using the entire range of the bass. Real groove oriented. That's Chuck Rainey's style. It's got incredible feel, and he has a lot of broken parts. You're not going to hear a bunch of eighth notes, straight eighth notes or anything. One of the greatest session bass players of all time. Okay, other questions here. I can't solo the track, so it's really, really hard to, it's really hard to hear. Ryan just had a very interesting thing. He says, Asia is their best album, but Royal Scam is their best rock album. And that's actually a really fascinating idea or fascinating concept there. Because one of the things that differentiated Steely Dan, their early period, to their later periods, is that they went from a rock band. If you listen to the first record, 1971 or two, Can't Buy a Thrill, that had Reelin' in the Years and Kings and Dirty Work and Do It Again, all these songs like that. These are all rock songs. They didn't have a lot of those jazz chord voicings in there. They had vamps to play over, like on Do It Again. Denny Diaz played great over the vamp section, like a jazz player would. But these records were rock records, and Royal Scam is a rock record. They started using the major seventh chords here and things like that, but they didn't. You didn't hear as many of the sharp nine chords. You hear the 13th chords in. If you just look at Kid Charlemagne too, you hear that B flat 13 that he plays that, on the B flat 7 chord. I was just playing that. They can't see me. Yeah. That's one of the only times in that track that there's a dominant chord. He's like, but that lick, once again, is an upper structure triad. He's playing on B flat 13, and Carlton's playing a C major triad on there, which gives you the upper structures, give you a 9, sharp 11, and 13. He's singing. Mixolydian sharp 11. Great, great, great sound. Once again, there's your gateway into jazz right there. It's really, really amazing. Do I expect jazz influences to creep back into pop music anytime soon? I wish they would. I wish they would. I don't know if you know. I'm not writing songs. It's up to people Carol's age that to bring back adding those chords into pop songs. Did somebody do a super chat question? What was it?
It's not a question. It's just
thank you.
This is from Stephen Kravis. Excellent, Rick. Love Steely Dan music.
I really appreciate that. It's very, very cool. Beato book sale, by the way, 20% off. I do this in the live streams. Dan, D-A-N 626 is the code for it. Anyway, so, you know, I like to bring back these old tunes like this. I think it's important for songwriters to realize that it's worth experimenting to try to find different sounds that people have not heard before. Really important. And when you never hear them on radio, you become afraid to write them. And I noticed that there was this fear of I noticed it when I was writing in Nashville a few years ago. I had a big hit song as a writer, and I went up to Nashville, I started writing with a lot of songwriters, and guys were afraid to write, guys and girls, men and women were afraid to write songs that weren't 1, 4, 5, and 6. Anything that was out of the ordinary, they just didn't want, because they were thinking, okay, this is gonna be too weird, we can't do this. And I hope that people, young people that are writing now, think about this stuff and say, you know what? I want to write something that no one's heard before. And your ability to write a melody, you can have really odd chord progressions. If you're a great melody writer, John Lennon, Paul McCartney, they wrote incredible. Strawberry Fields is an incredible melody over a very weird chord progression. This is an incredible melody over weird chord progression. Steely Dan did it all the time. And if you watch Donald Fagen talk about how he wrote Peg, for example, he talked about, he related it to a blues. And, there's a great video on YouTube. Just watch it. I won't do it justice telling you what he said. It's because it's fascinating. But I think that, same criticism Frank Zappa, Robert, writes of the music industry. You know, I was watching some Zappa interviews yesterday, actually, about this, for this exact reason. I wanted to hear what Zappa said in the 80s, how he was talking about popular music. he, you know, he did the, when they were talking about putting those explicit lyrics or the rating system they had for lyrics, that, you know, he went and testified before Congress and he had a lot of these same criticisms of popular music, obviously, and the lack of experimentation in popular music. Not everything had been written. Not everything was corporatized in the 70s, which is why you got incredibly diverse radio and you got incredibly diverse artists that wrote, really, if you thought about all the stuff going on at the time. Plus the fact that, you know, bands like Steely Dan had session musicians play with them. So they brought their own influences in. And you never know if Larry Carlton played these things and Donald Fagen might have said, oh, I like that, I'll play this under it. But I have a feeling that he just said, here's the chord chart, play over this. Music on the radio is created in the lab. Thank you, Nathan. That's it. It is created in a lab and put through it's created in a lab and then put through a focus group with maybe some computers too. Anyways, all right. So that's my take on Don't Take Me Alive. I mainly wanted to get on here and talk about the guitar solo, because I get asked about it all the time, to talk about Larry's solo on this, because it's really a legendary solo. And I think the people that, was this a single even, Carol? I didn't even say it was a single, did it? I don't even think this was a single. It just, people just knew it.